used to be an actress.
She ever do anything I would have saw?
I think her biggest deal was she starred in a pilot.
What's a pilot?
Well, you know, the show's on TV.
I don't watch TV.
Yes, but you're aware that there's an invention called television, and on that invention they show shows.
Yeah.
Well, the way they pick the shows on TV is they make one show, and that show's called a pilot. And they show that one show to people who pick the shows, and on the strength of that show, one show, they decide if they want to make more shows. So some get accepted and become TV programs, and some don't and become nothing. She starred in one of the ones that became nothing.
Good on you, Eddie. Good job. I'm sorry I aggressively pointed at you like an asshole. I was like...
You both did, didn't you? High standard, too.
Stuart Copeland was the drummer for
Police.
The Police. And I really do think that there is some resemblance.
Welcome to Couch Pilots. All of you are my friends. It's the show that dares to fly into the unknown territory of awful television. Pilots of the past. My name is Jason. And with me is the rare sexual unicorn. It's Captain Philip Bresisher. Good evening.
So like a unicorn in like the swingers like lifestyle.
Yeah.
It's the one that will do it with both. What happened?
I think it's like, from what I read up on this, I think there are probably different versions of this, but it's like if there's a guy and a lady together and they come across a lady who's like, I like both genders.
Right, yeah, that's the unicorn.
They invite them into the fold, as it were.
Sure.
Fold's a double entendre. And then so they bring them in, and that lady is a unicorn because she's rare.
Right, it's rare to find one that'll do both of them. Mm-hmm.
And I call you a sexual unicorn because... what's the Kinsey scale? What's that? Is that a 1 to 7 too, like us? I feel like it is.
We've talked about the Kinsey scale before.
You're right in the middle.
I'm trying to right in the middle.
You are right in the middle. So you are kind of a you're a bit of a male version of a unicorn. I think.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
You have sexual flexibility.
Yeah.
Yeah. You want to speak to that at all?
I don't think Roger will feel comfortable.
I'll give you 5 minutes to speak on it if you want.
No, I mean. Everybody knows. Things happen. Whatever.
Oh, yeah.
Nothing you want to speak to on that?
Well, I just don't know what we'll get out of it. Everybody already knows.
I have some questions.
Welcome back to the show, Andrew.
Andrew and Roger. Welcome back.
And Roger.
Andrew, you can ask any question. You're leading into it. You're helping me out. Go ahead. Ask any questions.
So legend has it that you've... had sex with 100 women?
Yes. Over 100.
Over 100, okay.
Yes.
So I had a question about what number is it if you took out like alcohol or other drugs out of
three.
The picture?
Yeah, it's 3. I would say that I had sex with most of them women sober. I'd say 79.
Oh, really?
Without this?
That's very specific that number.
Andrew's like, I had met him, and I was like, ooh, I just got to take a lot of drugs or a lot of alcohol.
I just feel like if people hit those numbers, I just had a long-headed theory that it has to do with a lot of alcohol.
I'm sure.
And
well,
drugs,
there was many a times where there was alcohol involved, but there wasn't a lot of one-night stands like you would think.
Yeah, that surprises me.
That is surprising.
Whether it was a weekend or a week or 6 months. Huh?
You're older than you look.
How old do I look?
Just be able to fit in 79.
Yeah. Well, you know, I used to have a good time.
Are you just free with the word love? I'm not.
No, I didn't love them. I fucked them. There's a difference. I never loved 100 women.
I don't feel like Blake would say I love you to a lot of people, but he does free love a lot of people. But I don't know if you're the same way, because last episode we were talking about, Roger, how you won't say, like I love you, Roger. but I know you wouldn't say that back to me, and I don't expect that. So I don't know where you fall on the I know where you fall on saying I love you, but as far as free love, like Blake, I don't know where you fall there.
And also,
he doesn't want to comment on it either.
I was trying to help him out. Actually, I was trying to help him out.
Thank you.
Yeah. So next question. There was more than one.
I feel like Andrew's got a lot of questions. He actually listens to this show.
Fire him off. Let's go. Let's do this.
No, that was the stuff. Let's see. I do have another one. I have another one.
Yeah. Let's get it all out in the air.
Like, because you didn't seem to remember being on the Karaoke Big E the other day when Derek was on,
Hoover Stank.
Hoover yeah. Boss. Okay. Yeah.
I call him Hoover Stank.
Okay.
But there was this moment where he where he was talking about
fucking more people than me.
Oh, so if he was alone with Robert Downey Jr., he thinks it would be cool to have their shirts off and maybe kiss a little. Like he thought
him and Hoover and him. Okay.
No, Hoover and Robert Downey Jr.
Right. Yeah.
Oh, you looked at me. I thought you meant me.
No. I was just clarifying because I don't remember a lot of it.
But. And then Jason, like his reaction was like, that is not the reaction I would have to that. And somehow that was. I think Derek thought that, and maybe even you a little bit thought that was like automatically made him like a homophobe.
Yeah.
Like that, as if it's like some binary thing. Like there's no nuance there between.
I guess for me,
I just love that moment.
Downey wouldn't do it for me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, who the fuck?
There's a lot of guys. There's a lot. Listen, Andrew. There's a lot of guys I would fuck. There are a lot of guys I would.
And
fuck.
He's not joking.
I have no problem with. Has it happened?
Yeah.
We don't know. Micro league baseball. It wasn't my.
Blake was molested.
That time it wasn't my idea, but. I don't have a problem with it. If I could just get my wife to fucking
no one's got a problem with homosexuality. And if just because I don't want to make out with
but see
Robert
I would
Downey Jr.
I wouldn't, make out with him. I wouldn't make out with him. Because yeah. I, to me,
maybe Hoover like, Boss was saying that for shock value. I don't know.
I'm like,
I'm not a shocking DJ.
No, not so much.
It felt honest to me. Like, but you know, the other thing is like Robert Downey Jr. is almost exactly the same age as Roger and I. I've been aware of him since he was like 20. You know, what I mean,
sure.
I don't know a single man or woman who thought like he's this hot guy. I gotta have him. He's not that guy. It was just so funny. Like the Derek. Of all people, I mean, unless he's just obsessed with Iron Man, the whole thing was
he's a comic book guy.
I would fuck Rob Lowe over Downey for sure, just because.
Oh yeah,
I have different tastes, but I'm kind of a. I'll tell you, I'll be honest with you, and Roger, I can't look at Roger right now because he's just looking at me like I'm the biggest fucking freak in the whole world. He's like
you're talking. That's what I'm looking.
He's
at.
Like I have no
stop
idea.
Stop talking. I'll stop looking at you.
Roger, I never stop talking. I would say for my fluidity, right?
Mm-hmm.
A transgender person is a lot more appealing than Rob Lowe.
Awesome.
And so that would be more of the avenue that I would take.
Can't do it.
As opposed to the other one, but.
Yes, we've heard tale of that many times.
I apologize.
Blake does have an affinity for transgender people.
And Bobby Socks.
And Bobby Socks. Have you ever combined the two?
Huh?
Have you ever seen a fella that turned into a lady that was wearing Bobby Socks?
Yes, yes.
That's got to be like...
It's got me through the night.
It's instant, right?
I'm like... I don't even have to think about it.
And
I click on it, I watch about 4 seconds of it, and I'm like...
I feel like the new taboo is like everyone accepts... That we're all looking at porn all the time.
Yeah.
We're doing it all the time, no matter what, always, forever.
Right.
All of us are.
Yeah.
No matter what. The new taboo is, what specifically are you into? And that's when like people are like, oh, I don't know. Blake, you wear it on your sleeve, and I applaud you.
The only thing I don't watch is anime porn. I don't watch anime porn.
It doesn't matter. You are honest about what you like, and for that, you are brave, and for that, I honor you.
Thank you very much. High five that
Absolutely.
Shit.
Absolutely.
So I think it's, I don't think a lot
my
of
my wife won't let me do a lot of.
I don't think a lot of people would say I like Asian ladies like shitting on feet. You know, like people wouldn't come out and be very specific about what they want. That's not mine. but like I don't think people will come out and say specifically what they're into. But you do. You are a fearless pioneer.
And that's why the other day my dad texted me. He said, "Hey, how do I listen to your show?" My dad didn't love me for a long time, but now he does, and so he wants to be buddies. And I said, you don't need to.
I don't do it anymore.
No, I said, you don't need to. Yeah, he's like, but then I thought, we need to have him on the show.
I would kill anyone in this room to have your dad on the show.
But, and I think that popped up because of a statement that Adam made a few years ago in regards to having somebody on a show that was really important to him.
This is many years. This is like 4 or 5 years ago.
And so that's what makes me think about it. But then I'm like, you know.
Well, I think what you're referring to is Adam Z, who made the trailer for our episode 300 video, and who was on that episode. He will go on to make the full video, and hopefully by the time this is out, that video will be available so that people can see the entirety of you versus Matt at the bowling alley. What he was referencing is he had got on mic him and a buddy who had passed away. And boy, oh boy, was he thankful to have his friend on mic, because he'd go back and listen to his buddy and his conversation anytime. And I think that's what you're referencing. You know, your dad is, no offense, he's not long for this world. And there will be eventually a time where he's not here.
Tooth.
That's right. And you'll be able to go back and listen to the conversation you have with him.
Yeah.
I would love to have him on. That'd be great.
Yeah, but I don't think that my dad is aware of... there was many years he wasn't around. You know what I mean? And for him, I think this would be such a shock value to him. Mm-hmm. Just, you know. And he'd be like, Jason would have been a better son anyway.
Yeah, of course he would say. Roger, are your parents still around?
Yes.
Okay, would they love to hear this recording of you?
Probably not.
Yeah, that's right.
But why do you think that is? I mean, you haven't said anything over the top. Do you think they'd be like, Oh, it's because of us, not because of you.
We were talking about pubic German sand lice earlier.
It's more, he doesn't want his parents to listen because...
Generally the salty content.
Right.
Yeah.
They're in their 80s. Yeah. You know.
Are they apostolic Christians?
No.
No. Well, Morton's ripe with them.
Yeah.
So I didn't know if that was... you guys are Mortonites, and that's fine.
Andrew, thank you for the questions. I appreciate that very much. Just
tone it down.
The urine treat.
Can I tell a story? Actually,
I would love it.
You know, there's been your dad Mike has been referenced on the show before, but never been on it.
Right.
I don't think. And
we got him on a phone call once.
Yeah, we did.
He didn't know it.
Oh, that's right. I heard that actually.
He didn't know it, but he was on.
And
a phone
you
call.
Have never, or you met him at the 300.
Yes. Okay. Yes.
But I actually have a story about your dad that I
would love it.
I never hear stories, and I just have a great. I have one that is a very fond memory of mine. It's funny. I don't even know what year it was. It was many years ago when you were young, you know. And
Andrew is my uncle, we should say.
Sure. So
we didn't mention that last
time. His mom is my sister, so
yes.
Mike, you know.
Yeah.
But he went over, and I went over there. I just went over to visit, whatever. But your dad was setting up the slot car set. I don't know if you remember the slot cars.
Sure, yeah.
I think it was the day he set it up. And I'm telling you, we just sat down and played it for like 2 or 3 hours straight.
Oh,
and
wow.
It was like the greatest time ever. Like we were both like kids. Like it was so much fun. We both had like the greatest time. And I can't tell you, in a weird way, it's a very fond memory of mine from like that period of my life. Like,
yeah.
In a way, your dad was not the, you know, we were close, like in a way, you know, he kind of kept himself, and he was a very busy guy, and most of the time was hanging out with Angie or you know, you guys. But it was this, we had this beautiful, like, 2 or 3 hours.
That's awesome.
That is still, huh? Oh, that's still very, it's very special to be there.
That's awesome.
Well, what's the size of plywood? Like a 4x8, right? Is that what plywood
is?
And I think he had painted it green. And he had just done like a figure eight slot track. And I can't imagine how quickly anybody would be bored with that. But two or 3 hours,
yes.
Just sitting around, holding down the trigger on this little, like, it weighs a half an ounce, this little trigger. I remember this. They're like orange. I remember it very clearly.
Right.
And you guys are sitting there probably just shooting the shit for 2-3 hours.
Oh, it wasn't even shooting the shit. It was like totally into the slot cars. Because the whole thing is you're trying to make them collide and you're actually racing at times.
There's a part where they cross over.
Yeah,
right?
It's crazy. Yeah, like, it was absolutely,
that's awesome.
Totally into it, yeah.
Family, friends, and memories. That's all you can take with you.
You can take those things with you?
Uh-huh.
God, I didn't feel like you could take anything. I felt like when you... Roger, what happens when you die? And what are your thoughts on abortion?
And what's your Social Security number?
Texas has got it right. Roger, right? That's not that much worse than just saying abortion, right? What happens when you die, Roger? Is it like you're unplugging the TV?
It's like a passing out, but extended.
Okay, so a deep slumber from which you'll never wake.
Yeah.
Okay. You ever been in a coma?
Not the
best sleep you'll ever
have. It's not the coma.
It's not the coma?
It's not the coma. I would love a coma. God,
and you deserve it. I hope that for you someday. I really hope you'll get that.
Roger, you don't understand. And Andrew maybe has a little. I am ready for death. I have no problems. I'm I got the flags going like this. I'm like, I have no, I'm not going to do anything to initiate it, but I'm very much not scared.
You want me
like,
to speak at your, you want me to give your eulogy?
Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
I'll do it.
Because I want you to speak at my eulogy because I will never be able to do the best man speech because you will never get married.
Right.
I've got three of them already written.
Well, I'm not going to get married until gay people can get married because I'm gay. That's a Harris Whittles joke.
I know it is.
Yeah. He was a great comedian.
I think you would be so much happier gay. I really do think you'd be so much
I'm thinking about it. I know it's a decision, all right?
It's strictly a decision. It has nothing to do with, you know, how your brain's wired.
But I think there is a gay Gene, though, don't you? Like, I literally know a guy named Gene who's gay, and his son is very questionable. He's married to an Asian lady, which Asian people are very ambiguous, if you ask me, with their sexuality.
Right.
So I really think there is, and I know I've heard of, heard tell of, like, twin sisters both being gay. I think there is probably a gay Gene out there
somewhere.
Sure.
I would agree.
Andrew, gay Gene?
Hashtag.
They're looking for it. I don't know. Yeah, I think there's something there.
Who's looking for it?
Nothing's definitive at this point, as far as I know. But yeah. There's a lot of
not a homophobic statement at all. It's just yeah. what que sera, sera.
Yeah,
right.
I actually think it's wrong to even pursue it in a way because the real thing should be who gives a shit,
right?
And just
yeah, absolutely,
and just and, do whatever and, do you.
Yeah, I agree.
In the episode and the third that we've done, I like Andrew's.
He's got good
who
takes.
Who gives a shit?
He's got good takes.
Who gives a shit? I'm like, you know what? That's
yeah. If you're going to search out the gay Gene, the real question is to what end?
Yeah, right. There's some agenda at work there probably. That's
sure, because they want
good
they,
or bad. Or
they want to have a pill for it or a shot that kills it, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
When you have your baby born, they want to micro it down to this is the gene. They find it.
Eliminate it.
And the mother and father have. But
well, or do you want, I mean, or. Purposefully having.
Thank you. That's also, yeah.
Like a person? I mean, like, nobody wants to purposely have gay or heterosexual person, I don't think.
Yeah. Like, if a father is like, my daughter, I'm going to sit there with a shotgun. I just fucking make her gay and I don't have to worry about it, right?
I always talk about leaving LBGQT literature around my house to make my daughter gay because
sure.
I don't want her to have any baby. It didn't work. I think she likes guys.
Ugh. Maybe you should have watched more Glee.
Yeah, no, it's an anti-Glee household.
That's a problem. Basically, what we're summing up is what Andrew says. It doesn't fucking matter. Yeah?
Yeah, no one gives... No. It's funny, too. My daughter. Speaking of my daughter, she's got a gay friend at school, and he's like 13, 14. I was like, does he have any problems at school? The kids didn't give him a shit? So she's like, no one gives a shit.
Yeah.
And I was like, that's pretty refreshing to think that the next generation is like... Yeah, who cares? Let's fucking move on to the next thing.
The generation that's coming up is they only care about what's going on with them, so they don't care. They don't care. They only care about what's going on with them anyway. So they're like, whatever, you know.
All right, fair enough.
It's all they care about is their TikTok.
Yeah, do you have any other questions for us? This is the part of the show where you ask us questions.
Right.
You said you listen to the show.
I do.
And Blake and I have a dynamic, which is undeniable if you ask me, Blake.
It blows up. It's so dynamic.
I don't have a question or a comment. One thing I've loved recently is it's beautiful that you said, describing your own house, you described it as gay as fuck.
Oh, I said my house is?
Yeah. And that was perfect. It really is. That was a perfect description.
Super hella gay. It's super hella gay.
You think so too?
It's either...
I don't remember saying that at all.
You did.
I believe you.
You can define it as super hella gay or super hella OCD, but I would lean toward the super hella gay for sure.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
I love it.
I do too.
I don't get invited.
It's not a knock.
No. I don't get invited to his house very often.
Right.
But when I am there, I
you smell like your dog's urine.
When I'm there, I feel very uncomfortable because
you don't belong there.
Because I feel uncomfortable because I don't want to mess any of his stuff up.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
It is. It feels like that kind of place.
Right.
It's very precise.
I've had a couple beers there before. Maybe shouldn't have had as many as I had.
Right.
And if I was to leave the can. And walk away. I would because I don't want to ruin his feng shui.
It's like installation art. Your house, really.
Yeah,
that's
installation art.
What's that?
Gay as fuck sounds like appropriation.
I am appropriating homosexuals, and in the right context, it's a compliment.
I had to force him to get a full size bed.
No, a queen. I had a full.
Yeah, I forced him to get a queen bed.
He shamed me into it.
It took me 3 years to get him to get one.
Much smarter people than I have claimed my house is a coffin that I will eventually pass away and then ultimately be buried in.
Amazing decor. He's very eclectic. He has a great taste, but it's just
I have a straight eye for the straight guy.
I think if you just had the front window, like the door window, like if it was opened, it wouldn't seem so like, don't come in here.
Oh, I put one of those frosted covers on my window because there's a huge pane of glass. I don't want people to see in, though. A huge
pane of glass?
Yeah. You happy with yourself?
Don't like the fishbowl effect?
What's that?
Don't like the fishbowl effect?
I don't want people to see what I'm doing in there because often it's awful. You don't get to have a house as gay as fuck, Roger, without doing some awful shit inside of it.
I think Roger is way overstimulated right now. He is.
Roger, you talk about come alive. Roger has come alive.
He's taking in a lot of stuff, and he's like, I should have stopped at dinner.
Roger says he's a process engineer, but no one here, maybe even Roger himself, can claim to know what that is. What's a process engineer?
Figure out how to make things over and over and
what's,
over
what's
again.
The last, manufacturing. What's engineer, the last thing you figured out?
Trick question.
I don't know. Okay, so if you had I have a widget. I have a widget.
Yep.
Okay?
Yep.
I'm coming to you to show me how to set up the process to make those widgets as fast and as efficient as possible, correct?
Ooh, good question.
Yep.
High five it. Nice job. So
refine it so you get higher yields.
But do you design the equipment that produces these things?
I don't.
Okay.
But I work with those pieces of equipment to make the widgets over and over again. So it's manufacturing.
Can you say what the last widget is that you worked on? Is it something that we'd recognize? Or?
No, you would not.
So can you say? I don't want to push you.
I've been in healthcare for
healthcare. A long
time. So last thing I worked on was a treatment for women's healthcare. You can go with it, Blake.
Blake loves pussy. Yeah. And I hate to say that word, but that's what Blake loves the most.
So yeah, it was treating polycystic ovary syndrome.
Yeah,
and so some women, their ovaries get a lot of cysts on them, and then they don't ovulate, they can't have babies. So this was a treatment for
so that they can have babies.
Yep,
that's a pretty good thing to be a process.
You know what? I
want to
meet him before they started Roger's process.
Lord. Are you saying you want to have sex with ladies full of cysts?
Well, that and the camp.
You're like John Stockton. Bunch of the cysts. That's an NBA joke.
Yeah, that's
right. I think the first hour and a half that me and Roger spent together, he's like, this guy's kind of funny. And now he's like, this guy's a fucking nutbag.
I don't think he thinks that at all.
No,
how do I get out of this house?
No.
Wait till
I was right there with you on the death thing.
Wait till I bring my wife out. We should have her.
I'd love to meet Molly, by the way.
Well, she'll probably be asleep. Oh. She.
That's what you said last time.
is she up there right now?
Huh?
Is she up there right now?
You want me to call her?
Thank you for the assist. Thank you for the assist. Pretty funny joke. I don't really have anything planned for this episode. With Roger being here, I thought we'd dig into him a little bit, but he seems apprehensive to do so. Are you calling Molly?
I do.
Let's get her on the phone. She can talk to Andrew directly. Your wife goes to sleep before 9?
When we record, she goes to sleep.
She's so over your lifestyle.
Yeah. What time is it?
It's not quite 9.
Yeah, it's not quite 9.
Hello.
My wife has a very masculine voice.
She sounds hot.
Hey, happy birthday, by the way. Happy birthday.
What? Is it Eli's birthday?
Yesterday.
Happy birthday.
Can I talk to my wife? Can I talk to my wife?
Mom.
Ma? Do you realize that you have your own cell phone, which if I wanted to talk to you, I would call you?
Well, she's not in the room right now.
Where's she at?
I don't know.
Can you just tell her bathroom. To come? Can you just tell her to come down here,
please? I take my phone in the bathroom. Okay, I get a lot done in the bathroom with my phone.
Just tell her to come down here, and if she doesn't, there's going to be hell to pay.
Oh.
Oh, she's going to come down here?
Hey,
words.
Don't say that part.
Okay, bye.
All right, bye.
He's a man now. He sounds like a man would sound.
Yeah, he's got a full-size bed now, too, and he's 14, and you were 36.
Doesn't matter how old I was. So you invited her down here to meet these fellas?
Because she's going to be asleep otherwise.
That's good. That's a good idea.
You're asleep.
I'm glad. Always have to glad have Molly on the show. Look, I'm on my fifth beer. What do you want from me? Today we discussed the pilot episode of Cheyenne Cinnamon and the Fantabulous Unicorn of Sugartown Candy Fudge.
You can always do it like this. It's the CC and TFU OSTCF.
This is the first time in the show that I say it, though, so I got to say it at least once in its entirety. It's from the year of our Lord, 2010. Now, that was a great year.
2010. Guys, I think I was about a year away from meeting Molly, and so I was getting
So this is a good year for the roses.
This is a good year for the roses. Rogers, when Rogers, Aaron,
so Roger, you're just cresting 100.
Oh right no.
Okay.
No. Roger, when somebody says, "Ooh, it was a good year for the roses," what do you think that means?
Rose Bowl. I don't know.
Pretty close. Pretty close, Rose Bowl.
You want to tell him?
You tell him. I'm embarrassed now.
Blake,
I think he hates me now.
He does. He hates me. I can read Roger. When I announced the year that the pilot was created, and Blake says it's a good year for the roses, it means he had a lot of sexual intercourse that year. Vaginal sexual intercourse. That's what that means.
Okay.
Blake loves women.
Does it have to be vaginal for it to be?
Good question.
You know what, Roger? It doesn't. That rule has... He's always assumed that rule.
I did always assume that. I don't know where your numbers lie. I don't know if you have a very Clintonian version of sex or not.
I would say the moon part, I would say 6 on the moon part.
What? Moon part?
This fits in well with this pilot. Right. We're talking about.
I guess.
Oh. And I'll just say right off the bat, this is getting a bump. This episode is getting a bump.
I know you jerked off to this pilot. That's all I'm going to say about that. Oh, boy. 2010, as you mentioned, and I mentioned, a great year, Year of the Roses. Let's go back to 2010.
In our minds.
And always we do this because we want to put you in the mindset of when this show was created, so when we talk about it, you can properly process and then regurgitate your own thoughts according to the time in which it was created.
Right, because we're in 2021, and this was in 2010.
Like 30 years ago.
2010, we did not have COVID. That's kind of an easy one, right? That's a softball.
Well, did we have COVID-10 back then?
They said it was COVID-3. It was COVID-3.
COVID-3 came out in 10.
Yeah.
Okay.
And back in 2010, we didn't have fast pitch softball. I mean, nobody had ever heard of that before.
Those girls can really whip it since then.
Back then, they just kind of tossed it. But now, I mean, if you watch some of those girls fast pitch softball, I no way. And in 2010, we also didn't have Vegemite, for sure. There was no such thing as Vegemite.
Have you ever had that before?
Huh?
I know Men at Work sang about it, but did you ever have
it? I've heard about it, but I've never had it, and so to me there was no such thing.
Andrew, did you ever have Vegemite?
I don't think I have. But the song from the 80s precipitated the creation of Vegemite
right
after 2010.
Exactly, so, yeah. Exactly.
They created it
Thank
based
you
on
for
the song.
Saving yeah. me, yeah. Andrew. Not you bad. Are on top of your shit. And also, obviously, we're near Peoria. In 2010, they didn't have penicillin, which was invented here
right.
in Peoria, but in 2010, they didn't have it.
Yeah, so. That's exactly right. Did you know that, Roger? Penicillin was created here?
Did not.
Well, you didn't know it was invented in Peoria?
Will it play in Peoria? It turns out it will.
Yeah. You know, when you're on on 74 and the old Chiefs Stadium, which is now the Bradley Baseball Stadium.
Nebraska and University.
The Hill, Nebraska University.
The Agricultural Center.
The Egg Center. Yep.
Yeah, that's where penicillin was invented. In 2011,
I will go one step further and say the subdivision in which I live, there's a farmer who owned it, and he had a daughter, and that daughter, the daughter worked at that agricultural center, and she caught something and died from
because of that.
Yes,
wow.
And she lived in the house that I live in right now. It's the very same house.
Wow,
I like that.
Look out for the black mold.
I seriously think I have a black mold problem.
Do you?
What should I do with that? Just rip everything out?
Tear it out.
That sounds gay as fuck. October 3rd of that year, Germany makes final reparation payment for World War I.
How much were those payments?
Well,
they finally paid their loan off. Like they finally own that S-10.
As part of the Treaty of Versailles.
I just want to know, the question was, how much were those payments?
132 billion gold marks.
Okay.
Does that satisfy your quest for knowledge? I have the information in front of me. Who was World War I against, Andrew? Do you remember?
Well, it's sort of the Germans again, but they were sort of... as most the Austro-Hungarian Empire was still, still kind of German.
I liked how Andrew said
he's right.
The Germans again,
always causing trouble.
Dumb
fuckers.
It was a rough patch with the Germans in the 20th century.
And the Ottoman Empire.
Yeah,
they were called the Central Powers back then. It's kind of a cool name. I don't know. They were against us and some other guys. They were against us and Japan. Japan would 10 years later or 20 years later come back and go against us, kamikaze style.
Yeah.
We're all the heroes of our own story, is that right, Blake? October 22nd, International Space Station surpasses the record for longest continuous human occupation of space, having been continuously inhabited since November 2nd, 2000. That's 3,641 days.
Wow. We had people living in space.
Yeah.
Think about that.
It's crazy. If you that long in space, I think everything atrophies because there's no gravity.
Well, it's not the same people, though.
Oh, it's not?
Is it the same
people? I guess you're right. It's continuous.
No, they're swapping them out.
Yeah, they're swapping them out.
How long would you guys? Now they're doing space where it's like is it
just
not
take
Jeff,
a trip? Just
it's not Jeff Bezos. It's Elon Musk.
Yeah, just shoot a rocket up, go up there for about 15 minutes, and come back down.
Would either of you guys do that, Andrew or Roger?
I would not. I'd get terribly sick. I'm sure I'm not good at that.
Because you were in a boat.
He was on
my boat.
He was on a boat and he couldn't fucking make it.
Yeah,
Roger. I don't think you were a part of the people that got sick on the sailboat in Chicago recently, right? You did not get sick.
No, I did not.
Would you want to go to outer space?
Sure, but I think they kind of vet you.
How so?
You go do a roller coaster ride or something?
Well, how would you? Don't you think you could make it through the vetting process? I think you could.
Find out. Right. But
would you? So you're saying you would be willing to go through the vetting process to go up there, and if you passed, you would go.
Mm. Yep.
Okay.
I think recently.
I think the ticket price might be a little.
Processed engineered that whole fucking thing. Did you see that?
That was pretty. You really broke it down.
I process engineered that whole question.
Well, I wonder what the vetting process is because I think
did
on the
you
most
enjoy it?
On the most recent like trip, it was just kind of a bunch of like random civilians that did it. One being like early 20s, like 20 or like
right.
So like what vetting process did that person go through to get to outer space? Was it a roller coaster? I don't know.
Yeah. Is more like people actually applying
just wrote
to represent the different kind of things that they were.
Right.
Oh, so like do you know about the young person who went up?
Not a lot of details, but somebody represented hope and somebody represented
who has hope.
I know there was various things.
Represented hope.
Somebody,
there's no such
seven
thing.
Deadly sins?
Somebody had a artificial leg, like at least half of an artificial.
What were they representing?
It was a whole thing.
fuck is happening? Hope and amputees.
Exactly.
I'm not against either of those things, but I don't know what that stands for. All right.
Yeah, I don't know. I can't recall. But it was something, goddamn it.
All right. Fair enough. October 25th, an earthquake and consequent tsunami.
It's earthquake.
With a PH, I'm sorry. Earthquake and subsequent tsunami off the coast of Sumatra, Indonesia, kills over 400 people and leaves hundreds missing. What is the both of you guys live?
That was 2010.
Oh yeah!
Wow!
Oh yeah!
That long ago.
You guys both live on the West Coast. What are the odds of a tsunami hitting either of you?
Pretty good.
Yeah.
With the size of an earthquake out in the Pacific.
See you down in Arizona Bay, right?
Yeah, because you can see the ocean. I'm 70 miles from the ocean, so I'm fine. But you're fucked.
I think I'm okay.
You're pretty
I'm,
high.
I'm,
you're pretty
I'm
high.
2,000 feet.
Yeah, you're fine. Actually,
I'm
good. You're fine.
Do you have but like
if it happened to be a beach day for me, I'm screwed.
Beachfront property.
Do you have a plan like in place if shit goes down? Do you like have a plan to like?
My issues are more for wildfire, not
okay. Tsunami. Okay, that makes sense. Yeah.
Do you come across a lot of wildcats?
Puma.
Yeah.
I don't personally, but we have a game cam that has recorded them on the property.
That's pretty cool, huh? I always hear about like mountain lions in California and stuff.
They're all coming down because they're out of food and water.
Oh, yeah.
They're coming down into like the...
Oh, yeah. They want that food and water. They go to the In-N-Out dumpsters and
you know what I mean.
Trying to get monster-style burgers and shit.
God damn it.
That's right.
Yeah. No,
I'm with you.
You should have said I love you.
I love you.
Okay.
Did I say it in the intro?
No, you didn't start the show.
It's weird that you made note of that, right?
I was looking for mine.
I think Andrew and I are pretty loosey-goosey with this love ship, but there's something going on with the two of you.
It's a little too precious.
It is. Molly says, I'm sorry, I'm not feeling well going to bed, which means...
Did you say these guys are all 1,000 miles away from here? They're not going to see her.
And I think that's, I can hear you. I can tell where you're at, Blake. I'm not coming down. I'm going to bed.
So it's an inebriation thing.
That's cool.
Yeah. All right.
Well, I tell her I love her.
No. I will. And you know what? She'll say I love you to you, but she does not say it to me.
Oh, boy. I'm safely and securely back in 2010 now. I don't know about you, Blake.
I'm there, buddy.
If you had to guess, Roger, why did we choose to watch Cheyenne Cinnamon and the such and such? There's three reasons.
Oh, man.
You know what? That's one. That's one.
It is a pilot.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
It was on Adult Swim TV.
He's kind of getting
He's kind of doing it. He's almost there.
It did not get... taken up for a subsequent show.
How much money did it cost?
And it cost
for us to watch it.
Nothing for us.
There you go.
You can find the entire episode of Cheyenne Sound by subscribing to Couch Pilots and SoundCloud, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, or your favorite podcast app of choice, and then simply click on one of our classically blue links in our show notes, or go to AdultSwim.com. And Andrew.
You know what to do, Tube.
Join the alt
right. Or no, do they?
Prepare for takeoff. He wanted to hear you say, join the alt right.
Oh.
What do you have to do to join the alt right? Is it a website thing? Is it like you go there like
I think you just have to buy a t-shirt.
You have to create an account?
You just buy a t-shirt.
You got to put your credit card in, probably. I don't want to do that. My credit score is very bad. I'm not going to go to that.
You were
website.
Just bragging about it.
It is actually very good.
What could you buy with that credit score right now?
I don't know. Like, I've heard tell that the credit score is kind of bullshit because they say if you close a credit card, it goes against you, and then if you open a credit card, like everything goes,
everything's
working
against you, right?
It's just kind of a bullshit way to keep people in line, and you know I'm falling right into line because my credit score is very good.
Right. I'm so proud of you.
What's your credit score, you son of a bitch?
I've got two divorces. I have a pretty fucking bad one.
Can't do it.
Summary of the pilot. An adult-themed show in which a pop princess that lives in a candy wonderland helps a pregnant teen from Detroit learn there are more important things than taking care of your baby. Blake, you want to grade that?
That's an A+. That's, in regards to a summary about a pilot, that's A+. And I don't give those very often. Roger, I'm not a big A+ kind of guy.
Roger, we have three different...
But you'll say I love you.
But he does.
Only to hear it back, to be honest with you.
We've got three different parts of the program with three different grading scales. It's very confusing.
I am thoroughly confused.
Some would say convoluted, but I wouldn't say it because I don't know what that means. But how would you grade that summary of the pilot?
Well, that was excellent.
All right.
Great. Well, we now have four.
Pass. Can we just do pass, fail?
Or satisfactory.
Oh, satisfactory. Yes.
That's a good one. Andrew, you want to weigh in here?
That's
you
don't a have solid to. A.
An A.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you, that was fine to work.
Interesting facts. Blake says stuff during this part. I think we should just keep playing the music till he comes back. Oh, actually, do you guys have any hot gossip?
Yeah, I guess not.
Do you have any hot gossip about me?
Oh yeah, yeah.
What do you got?
I didn't hear anybody saying anything about you when we were up there.
So you got about seven of you that get together every once in a while that all kind of went to high school together, and you guys maybe meet up somewhere, plan a long weekend.
Last time was 2 years ago.
Yeah, pre-COVID.
Yeah,
but yeah, we tried
was
to
that
when
your friend had passed away?
It was inspired by our friend, a common friend that passed away a few years ago from cancer, and we kind of all, you know, reconnected while we were with him and stuff. And,
that was Dennis, is that right?
Yeah. Oh, wow, yeah.
Okay. Well, no, it is. I had a friend pass away.
That's impressive.
I had a friend pass away this past year too, and it's weird. Like, I don't know how you guys think about Dennis, but like with my friend who passed away, it doesn't feel real to me.
Yeah, and your friend was much more in your life. I've heard you talk about it a bit. He was pretty present, even currently, right?
Yeah, it was Lucas is what we're talking about.
Oh,
and Lucas was on the show a number of times, and he got COVID-19. I think he had a myriad of other medical issues. But when you throw COVID-19 on top of that, it creates a real problem. So much so that you die from it.
Yeah.
So it was a real bummer. But
for us, it was a little different because he wasn't super present in our lives for the last 10 years even. But
right.
it's more that we just all knew each other from that time.
Sure.
But it brought the rest of us together, and it's funny. And we still sort of meet and reconnect, and it's in memory of him in a weird way.
Yeah. Blake, you know what movie I saw recently?
Encino Man.
Yeah, obviously, of course, yes, Encino Man. But on top of that, The Big Chill.
That's right.
The Big Chill, which almost mirrors your experience exactly, right?
Yeah, it's very similar.
Yeah, it often comes up when we get together. It's like, we had to watch Big Chill. It's like, no, we only have like 3 days together, so we're not going to.
Oh, did you guys really watch it when he
passed? There was talk about watching it. No, we haven't watched it yet, but we talked about watching it this weekend. But.
Do you know, okay, so The Big Chill revolves around people that like went to college together, maybe like 10 years after their college experience. Well, that's fine. That's fine. We'll keep it playing. Blake's got an auditory OCD. they gather together because one of their friends had committed suicide.
Right.
Do you know who the actor was? Who was the guy, the dead guy?
Kevin Costner.
That's exactly right.
Really?
That's exactly
Holy
right.
Shit.
And he's not even in the movie, really.
And he was kind of a nobody at the time. And because they ended up cutting out all, he had other scenes that they shot,
yeah.
And they cut it all out. And in a way, Lawrence Kasdan, who directed it later, gave him a big role in Silverado because he screwed him out of Big Chill.
Yeah.
You know, man.
That's a whole story. That's some good knowledge.
And so they all got together and they spent the weekend with each other getting drunk and fucking each other, right?
Trying to.
Yeah. Hey, Roger, my book, if you're not trying.
Can you help me out with interesting facts?
Oh. I apologize.
Maybe turn up a little bit too now that we're going on it.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Interesting Facts. This is the part of the show where Jason has scoured the internet to find out facts about this pilot that you may not know. All we ask is during this segment to not give your opinion. And
Roger just flipped you off.
You know what?
He doesn't like this part of the show.
He is very unhappy about this part of the show. But we just ask that you keep your opinions to yourself.
Does that include gesticulation? Because Roger might...
You know what? To be honest with you, that's never came up before. You do that all you want. As long as you don't verbally communicate your opinion with someone else. But we did have the caveat that you can share your opinions with an animal, a cat.
That came up
a
long time ago.
Yeah. So that you can do. But just don't taint anybody's experience. And we can proceed with the facts about this pilot. I have one too, by the way. So
you have an interesting fact?
Yeah. If you don't hit it, I will hit it.
Ooh, boy, if I hit it, I hope you don't quit it here. Cheyenne Cinnamon and the Fanta.
Sorry.
Are you done?
I was just getting my fact ready.
Is that really necessary to do that?
Huh? I like to make a lot of noise when I've done some work.
Oh, I know you do. Cheyenne Cinnamon and the Fantabulous Unicorn of Sugartown Candy Fudge, often shortened into Cheyenne Cinnamon, thank God, is an American animated television series pilot created by Dave Willis and Matt Harrigan and mainly produced by William Street. It was animated by Radical Access. Fact.
That's a fact.
Rated TVMA, the pilot episode aired on Cartoon Network's late night programming block Adult Swim on March 29, 2010, but was not picked up for a full series. Fact. Excuse me. Cheyenne Cinnamon has been seen and mentioned numerous times on the Adult Swim program Squidbillies. Was that it?
Fuck this show.
Well, go pick it up. I'll skip that one.
No.
All right. Dave Willis.
That's all I had.
Well, tell me the rest about it.
No, the clips from this pilot were shown on multiple episodes of Squidbillies.
Okay, yeah. Have you ever seen Squidbillies?
Yes.
I have not seen it. I've heard good things.
I used to watch Squidbillies because of, God, what was his name? He did the song for it. The Unknown Henson. Unknown Henson did the music for it. Unknown Henson, very long ago, before it was a thing, got canceled. You know how they cancel people now?
Sure.
Yeah, he made some statements. He was an old guy who played music, and he always dressed like kind of like Dracula.
Oh, yeah? Okay.
And he did a lot of the music and a voice, I do believe, for that show. And... at one point, well, I guess there was one night, this was before any of this stuff was a thing, but one night he got drunk and he made some comments on Twitter, and literally his career was squashed that night.
Vaporized.
That's a great contribution. Thank you, Blake.
So I kind of had one, but would not have one.
Yeah, it chambered in there. It was pretty good. Thank you.
Chamber of Commerce.
I don't know if that's accurate. Have you ever heard of Squidbillies before, Roger?
No, I have not.
It's about squids that are hillbillies, so it's exactly what you think it would be.
it's got an imagery about it.
And it's as good as you would think it would be.
Yeah. I thought it was good.
I thought your interesting fact was...
But also, from Squidbillies as well, there was a lot of roots music that was played on there. I think Split the Prairiefield was played on there. Yeah, so...
Thank you.
Split the Prairiefield is my second favorite band ever. So.
Dave Willis explained the plot as a strawberry shortcake pop princess that lives in a candy wonderland just outside Detroit. She comes into Detroit and helps solve problems of racism and teen pregnancy with the power of love and teen pop songs. Fact. The pilot episode was first released in the United States as part of the Adult Swim box DVD box set, which also contained pilots for Welcome to Etlingville, which we've done, and Totally for Teens, which we shall do this season, on October 27th, 2009. That was my birthday, whatever, it doesn't matter. The pilot was later posted on AdultSwim.com as part of an online poll entitled Big Uber Network Sampling. In early 2010, the pilot episode eventually aired on television in the United States, again, on March 29th, 2010, in fact.
That's your birthday? Do I need to write that down?
No.
I didn't know your birthday.
I know your birthday. It's March 15th.
Seriously, you didn't know his birthday?
No, I know his birthday.
1976.
It's 1975. Well, I know your birthday.
That's right.
It's on my calendar.
Last fact is alternative country singer. What's that? What'd you say?
I don't know. Roger, for the last 3 years in a row, I did not know my wife's birthday as well. So if I don't know my wife's birthday, there's no way I can know his birthday for sure. Thank you, Facebook, by the way, who continues to help me out through that.
Are you on any social media, Roger?
No, I'm not.
Sorry. I recently joined, in the past year, I joined Facebook so I could use Marketplace to sell and buy things that I want to buy and sell. What do you think about that?
Can't you just do eBay?
Yeah, you could. I choose not to.
Has Facebook passed up eBay in that capacity, do you think?
I feel
locally,
like...
Locally.
Yeah.
Makes it more local.
Yeah, it's like I can meet you rather than going through all the rigmarole and loss of funds through eBay and, you know, the shipping.
It's past Craigslist, too, then, for local?
Well, I think we were talking earlier about vetting, you know? I think there's a better vetting process on Facebook because on Craigslist, you get any Tom, Dick, or Harry, and you don't want those guys showing up at your house. It'd be like a Russian coming to get your dishwasher.
No one wants chickens.
No one wants that. They took live chickens away from your house. Is that right?
They did. Well, we found other homes, but that is an option for getting rid of chickens.
Just real quick, previous Drew.
What's that?
Previous episode.
That's right. Yeah. Okay. Go back and listen, won't you?
I didn't. So I am in the process of going to be purchasing chickens.
This is not going to happen.
Can't recommend that.
No, say it louder so I can play it for my wife.
Can't recommend that.
Andrew, should I buy chickens for my wife?
No.
Thank you. All right.
And I say that as somebody who loves Molly. So, yeah.
Well, let me ask you this.
She doesn't love you enough to come down here because she don't feel good.
Why did you have chickens just for the eggs? Or what was the purpose of having chickens?
It was more for the experience, I think. And my wife and daughter, like, really, we're into having that experience. But there's the eggs. They don't taste any different. We did taste test even. And they're... The most expensive eggs in the store are cheaper than the actual, you know, with the cost of the eggs that you get from chickens ultimately, because it's expensive to keep that going. But I can't recommend it.
My boss, I went out in the country this weekend. He threw us a party and he has a pet turkey, a female turkey, and you can pet her and everything. And this
a hen.
Huh?
A hen.
Well, a female turkey's called a hen.
Yeah. Well, male's called Tom.
Oh, Tom well, Turkey.
But they named it Turkey, so that's why I call it.
They named the turkey Turkey?
Yes, ma'am. And so today, my boss comes in, and we were wanting to have breakfast. We're like, oh, we're so hungry. We should have had breakfast, you know, before we came in. And he's like, oh, I made a burrito, and I scrambled a turkey egg, and I had onions and everything. And I was like, I didn't know turkeys laid eggs.
Yeah. All so, foul. All foul.
I don't know if they do it on a daily basis, though.
Right, I think they're yeah.
Chickens they're... seemingly do, but other fowl I can't speak to. But what I can speak to is my sister has a very large chicken coop at her house.
Right,
and I think at the most she had 9 chickens that were active. But I went out there once with her, and she says, "I'm going to go into the chicken coop now." And I have this big stick, and it's got a pointy thing on the end, and I scrape chicken shit.
Yeah.
That's what I do. And I think I can't think of a time in my life where I'd want to do that. And it smells awful.
We need to take Molly and your sister out for drinks so they can talk about chickens to help her not want to
send Molly to the house while Sarah, my sister Sarah, does these chores and she can see it. My sister's fingernails caked with chicken shit all the time. And I don't know why she can't get it out of there.
And I don't know why she keeps like picking her teeth.
I think it builds immunity, but still, it's not. It's.
I think she eats a lot of licorice, then goes out there and does it.
Did you have something similar to that?
What's the old Woody Allen shtick about his brother who thought he was a chicken?
No, I don't know that.
And Woody Allen, you know, has a therapist and tell him his therapist.
This was during the time that he was a stand-up comic.
Yeah.
Okay. I don't know the bit. What is it?
Yeah. So he's talking to the therapist. Says, you know, my brother thinks he's a chicken, and the therapist says, well, just you know, have a talk with him, let him know that he's not a chicken, and Woody Allen says, I can't do that. I need the eggs.
Do you do a good Woody Allen?
I do not.
I was gonna say you didn't do it there, but but do you do a Woody Allen?
No.
How about you, Blake? Do you do a Woody Allen?
I don't do impersonations.
Blake does.
My brother, holy smokes.
Blake's impersonations are great. Watch, he's going to blow you out of the water with this Woody Allen.
What do you want me to say first?
Just say, what was the punchline there?
I can't do that. I need the eggs.
Hey, there you go. This is Blake's Woody Allen, right?
I can't do this. I need the eggs.
Oh, my God. Incredible.
That was beautiful.
Sweet.
Right. That was really
I do
good.
A couple more that are better, but really I'm good. Still working on
Thank
that.
Thank you. Like, thank you for doing that. Appreciate it.
Anything for the team.
Yeah, but I think the through line is don't get a chicken because they you have to scrape up shit, and that's a disgusting thing.
But
to
you
do.
Can hypnotize them, though.
Again, I think that's a... what's that guy's name? Fuck. Oh, Iggy Pop. Do you remember that song, Iggy Pop? Well, he did that song.
Chicken fucker?
No, from the Train Spotting soundtrack that was so popular, "Lust for Life." He talks about hypnotizing chickens in that song.
Oh, anyway.
Do you want me to show you a video?
Later.
Okay. Well, no, I'm not going to do it right.
Much
now.
Later.
Roger has things to do. We're not going to do it right.
All right, I'm skipping the last part of interesting facts.
It was probably the best part.
Twitter responses.
Cue me up. I need music for Twitter responses.
I never play music for you, but okay, take this.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's time for Twitter responses. This is a part of the show. Here, turn them off.
This is dope.
Here. Play Miley Cyrus. Roger, do you know who Miley Cyrus is?
Twice a month to discuss and analyze.
Andrew, do you know who Miley Cyrus is?
Of course.
Okay, turn all those off. Play Miley Cyrus and then go ahead.
Molly Cyrus or Miley Cyrus?
Miley. Not Molly.
Just checking.
My wife's name is Molly, so I fantasize that she's Miley Cyrus a lot. I would take.
You don't want to do it to this song?
Thank you. But you're playing all the other stuff besides her. Just play Miley Cyrus. And then I'll do it. Twitter. You're fucking with me right now.
I don't have any Twitter responses, if that makes
okay.
a difference.
That's fine.
Just skip it?
Yep.
Okay.
Play Miley Cyrus so they can hear her.
I feel like I just did like five times.
But by itself. Isolate.
I'm surprised there's none.
Yeah.
Should
you
be surprised?
Yeah. It'd be cool to hear from Nico Case.
Or T-Pain.
Cool. Oh, my God. I bought the T-Pain microphone. You guys ever hear that?
Oh, yeah.
Do you know what the T-Pain microphone is?
Is it a auto-tune situation?
That's exactly what
it is. Oh, is that what it is? Okay, yeah.
It's a little plastic thing. You speak into it, and you kind of T-Pain your voice.
Oh, yeah. Hold on a minute. Go ahead and do that again. Hold on.
Do what again? Do what
oh,
again?
Oh, yeah.
What are you
oh,
doing?
Oh, yeah.
What are you doing?
It's T-Pain.
Okay. I don't know that that's right. Let's put 10 minutes on the clock. And let's break down the pilot episode of Cheyenne Cinnamon and the rest of the words.
Jesus Christ.
Blake, you want to start us off? And then obviously, just like last time, Andrew and Roger, if you guys want to chime in, it would be a great time to do so.
Okay. We're starting off. It's like a computer animation. It's not like drawn. It's computer animation.
Yeah.
I thought it was like, I was like, it's a little upgrade from Dire Straits in a way, right?
Yeah.
Money for nothing.
Yeah.
Right?
And so this guy is holding a baby, and he's like, oh, cute little baby. And then he throws it through a window and yells, TVs, and people go get the TVs.
What's the point of this part? Because it doesn't bleed into anything, I don't think.
I think it does.
Okay.
I think that is Emily's mom and dad when they were young and first had her.
Wow. How did you get to that?
Because of the graphics of both of them. If you look at the picture of the lady standing next to the guy who throws the baby into the glass,
okay,
it is the two of them, Emily's parents, at a younger age.
My mind is blown here.
No, I'm serious.
I didn't think about that.
We can watch it right now. Wow. I'm absolutely sure that's what happened.
Andrew said he watched it a couple times, right?
I did.
I had watched it twice, too. I watched it twice.
How many times did you watch it?
Just once.
Did me, too. That's all I said. But did you pick that up at all?
No, I didn't pick up. I thought the production value was great. I almost watched it a second time, but I was like, nah, I don't need to.
Well, wow, I think
you've never done a podcast about TV shows before. You had to watch it three or four times.
That's I did not pick that up at all, Blake.
Oh,
that's
no, I would 999% sure that's what that was.
The police that show up are obviously just regular uniformed police, but there also seems to be like a RoboCop situation happening there, right?
Right.
Yeah, yeah.
It seems like the SWAT team. Right,
but that robot, it looks like it's from RoboCop. What was RoboCop 1 or 2?
Never saw it.
2 had the, or maybe they both had the robot ones. I think, yeah.
I
can't remember, but yeah, it seemed like a dystopian near future.
Sure,
that they're depicting. I mean, I didn't pick up on that angle though. That
yeah, Detroit's blowing up. Everything's going bad. You move outside of Detroit, and that's where we continue.
Yeah, the opening of the show is like a very Britney Spears type song and singing voice.
Baby, baby, yeah. I shouldn't have been.
Overtly Britney.
Oh, overtly, for sure. We see Cheyenne riding a unicorn and singing the title of the show over and over while like grinding on the air, very sexualized, right?
On the unicorn, she's flying on a unicorn.
Roger, how would you describe Cheyenne Cinnamon?
I thought it was high production value. I don't know exactly what that means, but I thought it was well done.
So you're saying she looked fucking hot?
The actual character. How would you like in appearance? I wasn't very clear. That's my fault.
If you would have shut up, I would have. He would have said yeah, because he would. You specified it too much.
I'm sorry. I just meant the appearance of Cheyenne Cinnamon, like the main pop star character. How would you describe her appearance?
Booby.
Yeah. One big boob, right?
Well, two big boobs.
Oh, that's right. Two big boobs. Andrew, you want to piggyback on that?
You know, she had the thong coming out the back. You know, she was a tad hypersexualized, you know,
Did they call that a whale tail?
I'm not sure who they are, but in this case.
The zeitgeist?
TikTok?
No, but you've heard that phrase before, right? A whale.
Yeah,
tail.
I think that. Yeah,
is that what a thong is showing?
It's when they have their shorts down low and they put their thong up high. And
but a whale isn't a whale isn't sexy though, right?
But it looks like a whale's tail from behind.
I guess, but that to me that's you should come up with a name that it gives me a boner. Like maybe a
fucking whore,
right? She's got like a crop top and pigtails. She's got a very big head with large eyes.
And she's got the Garth Brooks microphone, too.
I always call it Garth Brooks. You want to high-five that shit. Two parents that try to talk to their pregnant teenage daughter, Emily, out of marrying her softball coach named Todd. Emily is voiced by Kristen Shaw. I don't know if you guys know her.
Yeah.
From Bob's Burgers.
And Flight of the Conchords.
Last Man on Earth. Yeah.
Yeah.
Did you watch Last Man on Earth?
I liked it.
Will Forte is the best, is he not?
Yeah, it was good.
He's the greatest.
I watched it for a couple seasons, and I kind of just lost track of it. But
so
it was
weird.
It was inconsistent as hell, but it was...
It was the weirdest, one of the weirdest shows to ever be on primetime television.
Super unpredictable.
For three or four seasons, right?
I saw the whole thing. I love Will Forte. He's the best.
I think she is like like her voice makes her really hot. Like she's not an attractive woman, but her voice makes her hot.
I feel like she's the female equivalent to like Steve Buscemi. There is a place in the performance arts or the acting world for like sure. like slightly odd looking people.
Right, and I think for every role she didn't get, she got roles. You know, for all the roles she didn't get for the way she looked or sounded, she got
just as twofold. Yeah. Well, she plays Emily, and her softball coach got her pregnant, and apparently he's already married.
Yeah, Coach Wallace.
Oh, is that his name? Todd Wallace.
Yeah, and so in this first scene, so the first scene with the baby getting thrown through the window, look at both of the man and the woman standing next, and then watch this, and it's just them at an older age. It really is. And
why do you think they would set it up that way?
I guess to represent like how shitty parents have shitty kids that grew up to be shitty parents.
Like if parents don't say I love you to a kid, that kid won't say I love you to their children.
But he'll pretty say funny. It to other people, for sure.
Pretty funny observation. No,
for sure.
All right.
You know, that to me that was the analogy of it.
Yeah.
Right? And so you know, the dad's like, oh my gosh. And he's like you know, she's like, I'm in love with him and everything. She's like, well, there's love's really, is you know, people don't get married unless they're, you know, they're pressured into it by like blah 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 or being pregnant, and come to find out, yep, she's pregnant.
Yeah.
And so then the mom is like, you didn't use those condoms I gave you, and then the dad is like, instantly is like, did you poke holes in them? And she's like looks, you know, and so.
Then she runs away to a forest.
Well. I want to say a line before she runs away to the forest.
Please.
She gets very upset with her parents. And so she runs out of the room, and her dad goes, well, the softball season shot. Which I thought was perfect.
I don't want to stereotype or anything, but she kind of gives, she's I think purposely looking kind of white trashy.
Trailer park kind
of. And she's got the.
You think?
Well. Yeah, I just try to approach it softly. I don't want to offend anybody in the room, especially Roger over here. But she had like eyeliner that's running like
sure, because she's been
throughout
crying.
The entirety of the program.
And her hair has been dyed. She has black hair, but it's dyed yellow.
That's right. Well, she runs away through a forest that's becoming more and more candy-like until she runs into a large talking gingerbread man. Is that right?
Yeah. And he's like, hey, you can't, you know. And she's like. And when she's talking to her parents, there's a lot of posters on the wall of this
Cheyenne Cinnamon.
Cheyenne Cinnamon.
Yeah.
So, and she comes in and she's like, oh, and they're like those gingerbread men are like bouncers. They won't let her in.
Yeah. One of them pins Emily down as they appear to be bodyguards. I think their names are Ron and Glenn. And I always appreciate when like super. Like generic regular names are given in extraordinary circumstances.
And isn't T-Pain one of the gingerbread men?
Yeah, it's T-Pain and MF Doom, who I think he worked with. Like, do you know Danger Mouse? He remixed those Beatles albums a long time ago. MF Doom has since died, I think. I think he died on Halloween a couple years ago, actually.
Thank God it wasn't our fault.
And then MC Chris, who I think is a
white guy, right?
I think so. And he works with Adult Swim. I think he worked a lot with the... Aqua Teen Hunger Force. Yeah. So that's all. That, don't ask me anything else. That's all I know. So they're bodyguards for Cheyenne, and Cheyenne sings and dances and with like two black backup dancers who are like equally
scantily dressed
and endowed booby wise.
Right.
You ever used the phrase booby wise before, Roger?
Boobalicious, but not booby wise.
Ooh, I like that.
Body so boobalicious, right?
Man. So you'll find during this pilot, there's a lot of times where she breaks off and starts singing a song, in which this is probably the first time we see that.
Besides the intro. Andrew, you're taking a bunch of notes. I want to give you free reign to tech. No one else brings a computer in here with notes on. What do you have next here? Are you following along?
Yeah, absolutely. Let me see here.
This is basically when Emily first met Cheyenne.
Oh, it was the funny part where, actually it was cute when she said, did you get my letter? The girl said,
yeah.
Like, and she said, she with you know, fake confidence was like, yes, I did. How's your, you know, Hodgkin's, your non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. And then she said, no, that wasn't me. And she starts to explain the real thing. And then she was just like, yeah, whatever, you know.
Yeah. She's like, you know, Emily, I've been guiding you from afar with magic and also love. And then she briefly sings about exactly that.
It's really nice that she said with love, because only Andrew and Jason in this room would say that to me.
Roger, do you think you would say that you love Cheyenne Cinnamon?
No. Mm-hmm. No. It'd be more of a lust sort of thing.
Thank you.
What if I told you she was 12 years old?
Cheyenne is just like Miley Cyrus.
Yeah.
I will spend the weekend with her and have the best weekend of my life, but I will never take her home.
You know, in a recent interview, I heard her say the exact same thing about you.
Amen to that.
The bodyguards of the gingerbread guys, they're very protective. There are apparently three of them now. We had mentioned T-Pain, MF Doom, and MC Chris. And Cheyenne gifts Emily a laminated all-access pass to Sugartown Candy Fudge, which apparently is the area right outside of Detroit.
Right. It's right outside of Detroit. And the unlimited pass...
Are we supposed to know that?
It says on the sign. It says on the sign. It's fine.
Right outside of Detroit?
It says just outside of Detroit.
It says outside of Detroit on the...
Do you remember some of the settings that Cheyenne toured Emily through?
Flying over?
Yeah, yeah.
Vaguely.
I think corn syrup was mentioned.
Rock candy.
Roger's not a guy who wants any extra sugar.
To be honest with you,
this must have been a fucking nightmare for
right.
Roger.
To him, he was probably flipping
off. No added sugar, please.
Flipping off his phone the whole time going, I'm not eating any of this shit until... We got to the mountain.
Natural sugars only. That's what Roger says. Don't give me this fucking garbage, right?
No added sugar.
Processed bullshit? Roger's going to be the first guy to live to 150.
I hope not.
So, you know, they're flying over on a unicorn, by the way. This little plastic kind of looking purple unicorn. And they're flying over all this stuff. And basically, she's describing it, and it's like a festival place, like, you know what I mean? There's all these different spots and porta potties and everything.
Yeah.
And then they look over and the unicorn starts freaking out.
Unicorn's name is Ulysses, turns out.
Because of the Confederacy.
Is that right? Is that why?
Oh, it's
I think sure. Ulysses fought for the North.
Oh, no.
No, he didn't?
You read it wrong.
Who was buried in Grant's tomb is what I want to know.
Huh? Malcolm Jamal Warner.
Malcolm Jamal Warner was buried in Grant's tomb? Yeah. That's news to me. They head towards, what's the name of the volcano? Do you remember, Andrew?
Is it Cocaine?
Oh, I think it was Cocaine-O.
Cocaine-O. In this?
Which is not honestly not a bad name.
No, it's not. And it's a big, you know, it looks like a big mountaintop with like snow. And come to find out, it's made of cocaine. And they, you know, they go in there and Cheyenne just starts singing about how she's likes to snort cocaine, making snow angels and everything.
Cocaine angels.
And my favorite part, besides the boobs and the butt,
sure,
on this animated
she's 12 years
person,
old.
12 years old, but is they show this unicorn sniffing the shit out of, like, just deep diving and just sniffing a huge line of the cocaine.
Well, Andrew, there's a snowman involved here, which I can only assume was made out of cocaine. Do you remember what the nose was made out of?
I do not.
It was a rolled up dollar bill.
Mm.
Wow.
Which is kind of funny. Anyway, everyone has nosebleeds.
Right. And she sings again about cocaine.
Emily gets stuck in a marshmallow marsh, and then they cut to Emily being covered in marshmallow in Cheyenne's like dressing room or something. And then they're looking at one of her softball teammates from afar, like back where she's from. Her name is Michelle. And she's being arse-rammed by Todd. What was his last name?
The Wallace.
Coach? Todd Wallace. And Emily kind of has a fit while Cheyenne is...
Right, because she's trying to show Emily that Coach Wallace is going to fuck anybody. They're not in love. That's the symbolism, right?
Did you ever have any scandals like that, Blake, when you were going to high school with like teachers and students?
I can't remember one for sure. Hey, do you?
No, I don't think so. Yeah. You fellas ever had that going on?
Did we have?
I thought we did, but I don't remember.
We don't have to give any names, of course, but I just didn't know if you guys experienced that, or at least at the very...
Certainly didn't experience that. It would have been rumor mill.
Rumor mill.
Didn't you fuck Mrs. Nussbaum?
Whoa.
Got a new show title.
can't do it.
Not too bad. Way to go, Roger.
Not a handsome woman, by the way.
That's probably why you can't say I love you to anyone, right? It's,
right.
It's tortured at an early age. But Cheyenne then sees Michelle, who's being arse-rammed, of course, by Coach Todd. She sees Michelle's Hala cell phone and becomes instantly infatuated with that.
Right. That was hilarious. And so then he comes to Gummy, which is Cheyenne's... It seems like her road manager is Gummy.
Yeah, how would you describe Gummy? Like, what relationship do you think Gummy has to Cheyenne, Andrew?
Yeah, that is... Yeah, it was almost like a...
Road manager.
Yeah, road manager, something like that. It was definitely trying to speak truth to the...
Truth to power.
To the situation, yeah. Truth to power.
Right, and like at the end of it, he was trying to take care of the problem, which the road manager does.
Let's get past and move on.
He said the hard stuff.
Yeah, for sure.
What does he encourage her to do?
Kill the baby!
Yeah. Each episode, I keep pushing Roger for answers on abortion. I think this Gummy's right up his alley. Just joking, Roger.
I like the Gummy character.
Yeah, yeah. Then Cheyenne starts to sing a song about keeping your virginity via anal sex, a la mouth. And this is my favorite phrase from the whole show, being a butt believer.
Yeah, for sure. And this is a long song. Like I'm not gonna lie, I looked for these songs like on Spotify.
You want to hear the YouTube. Whole thing?
I just wanted to have them for like for the show, but I was like this, which we've encountered in you know a lot of there are Christian women girls or whatever that like they're keeping their virginity, but they're getting
we've encountered them.
Well, it was
did you do an episode without me?
No, not Garfunkel and Oates. They have a song about the same thing.
Do they? Okay.
Where they talk about, oh, well, you're keeping your virginity if you're getting in the ass.
Okay. It is a trope, I would say, for sure.
Does it still count?
Oh, yeah, it counts, buddy. Cheyenne encourages Emily to marry Todd and raise the baby with him until the Gummy says, yeah, no, you probably should abort that baby.
Right, and then Cheyenne like gives her pills and Gummy's like, what the fuck? That's way too much. And then she goes to sleep, which in turn initiates the time lapse.
There's a giant ant that takes Emily away. Is that real? Did that really happen?
No, I think she was high and it was a way to like to initiate the time lapse.
What were these pills, Roger, that it was taken? I don't understand it.
This is where I fell asleep, I think.
That's where you fell asleep.
Oh, Roger.
Like 12 minutes, man.
Roger, we have like three rules on this show. One is not detain anybody else's experience.
No cops.
There's no cops. And then there's don't fall asleep.
Sorry. I watched
an hour and 40 minute pilot about Cro-Magnon Man where they
didn't
talk.
It was 6 years ago. Get over it. Fucking Christ.
Whoa.
You want to rile me up, man? Bring up the tribe again. It was 6 years ago.
You didn't watch it.
Of course. It wasn't available. Andrew, what do you think these gummies were that Cheyenne gave her?
I have to... some kind of sedative? I don't know. She didn't get any kind of reaction that would suggest something else. Other than that ant picking her up, I guess.
Yeah, I thought they were going to be like abortion pills. Is that a thing? I don't know.
Because Gummy actually says, like, let's scrape the baby from the lining of the, you know,
begs a manual process versus like a Plan B pill.
Well,
situation.
I think that Cheyenne's like, oh, that's kind of rough and kind of probably kind of aggressive and painful.
So you feel like they are abortion pills.
I think what they're saying is like, yeah, we're just going to give this girl pills and it'll, you know, anyway.
We cut to Cheyenne on top of what seems to be the Capitol building with a Britney Spears Toxic song. You remember that song, Toxic? I think it's like a ripoff of that.
Yeah.
And then she's doing
on a pole on the Capitol.
And she's promoting American democracy.
And voting.
Which really, it harkens back to me. What's that, Michael Moore, Fahrenheit 9/11? You guys ever see that show?
Didn't see it, but I know
you. Okay, so there's a portion of it where they, for whatever reason, Michael Moore, I think it'd be a good idea to put an interview with Britney Spears in there. Which is like, how much more to your point are you really? You know, it's, I don't know. It's disingenuous. As George W. Bush once said about him, but she was like Britney Spears was very like pro America and stuff, and to like a point where she's just being completely, you know, like manipulated by a gummy perhaps. But it felt like that. If this is like a complete ripoff to me of Britney Spears. This is sure. Totally from the soup to nuts. Britney Spears, right?
For sure. You know, so. The guy that's making a video, so the guy is like which I don't know if he was a walrus or a bear or whatever, but he's like, you're not being sexy enough. And for some reason, he says that, and then she comes over to like the control room, and she has no clothes on.
I think he tells her to get naked, doesn't he?
Does he say get naked?
I think she pulls him off and just goes, how's this?
Oh,
kind of thing. Okay. Yeah. She's completely naked.
You know what I said? Looks good to me.
This is the part where Roger said, I really like the computer animation, right?
He missed it because he fell asleep.
Did you really fall asleep through part of it?
You would have saw her naked right here.
Sorry.
No, it's I don't blame you at all.
You know, so she's talking to Gummy again. It's like, hey, you know, how's that girl that I helped? They show Emily with like a baby. And it's like, oh, you know. And so she's like, I'm going to take Emily and that baby to Vegas and party. So she goes to Emily. Again, there was a time skip after the pill.
Oh, yeah.
And so Emily has like 5 babies now. They seem to all be the same size, but one of them has an extra arm coming out of his head.
I didn't notice that.
Oh, no.
I didn't see that.
It's the one rolling all around on the floor. It has an extra.
Crap.
And the boyfriend or daddy, baby daddy or whatever is on the couch sleeping. And so Cheyenne's trying to get her and the baby to go to Vegas, and she talks about it's something in regards to the breast milk and a drink that was called the Titty Twister.
I think she puts vodka in the breast
milk.
She's living in a shitty trailer with Ramon, which I can only assume is Ramon, the father for the rest of those babies.
Great band, by the way.
Oh, I love Ramon. That's a great band. CBGB, what a great club, right? So Todd, the coach, was run out of the community, they said. And then Emily unwillingly heads out with Cheyenne on Ulysses the Unicorn. And the paparazzi kind of...
We're going to the Sky Bar.
In Las Vegas, right?
Yeah.
And so the paparazzi kind of forces them to crash land, and Ulysses dies.
Well, because Cheyenne has a cigarette and burns Ulysses' eye, and so he falls to the ground.
What a loss to the program.
So she did it too because she was worried about she's being shown with a cigarette because of her image,
right.
She had to put it out.
Emily is like, put that away.
The gummy friend there, the road manager, whatever he is, he tries to get Cheyenne out of there, and then Emily is kind of accosted by the same police that we saw in the very beginning of the episode, and then that's the end of the show.
Right, because Gummy is like calling the police. They've already shooed Cheyenne away. The unicorn's down, so the road manager, Gummy, calls the police and says, hey, you know, somebody stole our unicorn.
Please remain seated as we are now crossing a zone.
Anything else you want to add in there?
I don't think so. I'm fascinated, can I say that, by some of the odd details that you picked out of that?
The arm of the baby?
The arm of the baby,
the mom.
The beginning with the...
If you go back and... the parents... Listen, I will make Emily's you a promise parents. Right now. If you go back and watch it and you do not agree, I will mail you $10.
Some people say, like, adjectives for Blake, they say, like, well hung. Mine is always astute. Blake is always astute.
Yeah.
When you watch a lot of shit, you've watched over 300 episodes of shitty TV, right. you're longing for anything that stimulates your brain. And that is.
This was pretty good.
An arm coming out of the head is just...
This was pretty good.
I just don't know where it's going.
So good that you fell asleep. Roger, why didn't this work, you think? Why don't you think this worked? What was wrong with Cheyenne Cinnamon and the such and such?
A long day, obviously.
I missed the story arc. The story arc, I just kind of bubbled up.
There's got to be a story, right? Give me the story.
I don't know what it was, though.
I don't know that I know what it was either.
But everything, I mean, it was like the depiction of Britney Spears was
spot on.
Character was kind of fun. It was kind of South Park-y, you know, to show my age.
But, no, it's kind of as harsh as South Park. You know, it's kind of mature as, you know, with all the language and the tone and stuff.
For sure. That's a good analogy.
Andrew, is there anything you would do to improve this show?
The thing that it suffers from is just being, it's just one joke kind of going on. There's just not enough to the characters to be able to go anywhere with
there's
it.
There's no depth.
Ultimately, there's just no depth to it.
You can't sustain this.
Right? Yeah.
Yeah.
So, it needs to go... further in the character, development.
Give the character some development for sure. But Blake, if this was if this came on every week, what would happen? What would you like to see?
Well, and that's the problem I had with it. I couldn't. There was nothing to do every week because you have a character of Emily and Cheyenne. Does Cheyenne go into Detroit and deal with all kinds of different people about different things and teach them lessons? To me, the story was funny and good.
Yeah.
But when you always ask me,
I gotta know.
How does this keep going? Mm-hmm. It's tough to get.
Cheyenne helps somebody else the next week. Emily's no longer there.
Presumably, yeah.
It's a Pete's Dragon situation, right?
Oh God, Pete's Dragon.
Oh, you get Mickey Rourke involved, man. You'd have yourself a show, right? Good Lord, I'd love to have that. You like Mickey Rourke, Roger?
Yeah.
He's married to the most beautiful women in Hollywood, gentlemen.
Who's he married to?
I don't know their names.
What's your?
He's married like five times. Like
over his lifetime.
To like the most beautiful women you've ever seen. He stand a mighty 4'7", and he's
wait about 350.
I don't know about that.
About 350.
I don't think that's right. Maybe I didn't do my work here, but I don't see any. There's nothing here as far as reviews or anything.
I looked up it too.
Did you really?
No, yeah.
And you didn't say anything either.
No.
Thank God! I thought I just That's forgot surprising. To do this part of the show.
I worked so hard to get the first interesting fact. You fucked me on that one, so.
Yeah, I fucked you. 300 episodes of no work, one episode of work, and I fucked you on that. All right, let's skip to the end here. He told you that was his wife talking, right?
Yeah. And she said 69 degrees, which means like...
You know what 69 is, right?
Yeah.
I mean, we all know. Hey, Blake. You want to high five that shit, right?
It's kind of the bit I wrote that. Oh, it's hard to believe that those were...
She agreed to read it.
Yeah. And that's all she did.
Here's the thing, Roger. She doesn't know what it means.
And to think about it, it was almost 6 years ago that she recorded that, right? It was about 6 years ago that she recorded that at the duplex, right?
Yeah, I thought it was a townhouse.
Yeah.
Blake used to live in a townhouse. It was right next to a cemetery.
And then a tornado came and took the roof off of it.
You can't write that shit, Roger. Landing is the part of the show where we grade the pilot. What's that?
The townhouse or the cemetery part?
All of it.
Okay.
You can't write anything.
Hey, it was the most popular cemetery in town. Everybody was dying to get in it.
Not bad.
Boom.
Not bad at all. 1 through 7 is our grading
scale. Oh, my wife just texted me and said that wasn't funny.
No, she's hearing every fucking word we're saying down here, huh? We're going to grade it now. All four of us are going to give this godforsaken pilot a grade, and it's taken from the television show from the 1990s, affectionately and accurately known as Wings. We take a look at all the characters in the program. Number 1 is the worst score you can get. That's a character known as Roy Biggins. Number 7, that's the best score you can get, and that's a Brian Hackett. Andrew, I turn to you. How do you rate Cheyenne, Cinnamon, so on and so forth?
I'm actually going to go with a 4, even though it wasn't... I didn't see where it could go, but the songs had very high production values. And
it wasn't... I read some stuff on the internet. The girl that did the voice was not the one that sang the songs.
That's right. You're right.
You're right.
Yeah, so that's funny that she
even though she was a singer, too.
Right, yeah, she was a country singer, yeah. Okay. I didn't mean to interrupt.
Hey, we'll get back to you in a moment.
Sorry, Andrew.
It's okay, buddy.
Oh, no,
I just had an interesting fact.
Look at Andrew in the eye and tell him you love him.
I love you, Andrew.
I love you too, Blake.
Aww. We're going to hug.
He really needed that.
We're going to hug. We're going to hug in the garage.
I know.
Roger might not hug, but me and Andrew are going to.
We're going to get him. We're going to get you, Roger. We're going to hug you, buddy.
I'm not opening the garage door until you
hug me. You're stuck. So you say a 4?
Yeah, I'm going to 4.
Right down the middle. Roger, I turn my gaze to you. How do you rate Cheyenne Cinnamon?
I actually, even though I fell asleep.
Right. The hallmark of a great pilot.
I'm going to go with a 5, but I don't do this very often. So.
Was it because of the boobs?
Wow.
No, you can say
it is.
No,
was it because of the teen pregnancy?
Well, I don't see a lot of animated stuff, so I just thought it was like... Yeah. All the animation was done well. I mean, and the caricature of Britney Spears, and just, you know, I don't know. I thought it was what they did do right. They did right.
It was a classic send up.
It was good.
Yeah.
Both last week too was a send up, right? of The View when we did Yappy Broads. And this is kind of a send-up of teenage girl pop stars. Sure.
Speaking of...
So, but I mean, so assuming a 7, it should have gotten re-upped, but...
We liked it that much.
Yeah,
for sure. Jason, how do you rate?
I go on Me Before You.
CC. And, oh wait, CC and TFUOSTCF.
Pretty good. I don't know. I think Andrew hit it pretty good earlier when he said there's so much going on that there's not really much room. Where do you go next with this? How can you see this every week? I don't know if I'm paraphrasing you exactly or not. But it's...
He said something about chickens, too.
And also, chickens, also.
More chickens!
I like Kristen Shaw. Nico Case is pretty cool. You got a lot of cool people involved with this.
Wasn't the girl from Saturday Night Live on here, too?
Which one?
The one that used to do the stair thing where they would zoom in on her, the short...
Rachel Dratch?
I think she was involved in it as well.
I didn't notice.
I saw
her picture on when I Googled it.
I don't think that's right, but who knows? Maybe Rachel Dratch was in it in some capacity. I didn't love this. It was kind of dumb. It's a great like one off send up. Like this is a fun thing you could do. Just put out there to say, look how and a steal word from you earlier, Andrew. Say how vapid these pop stars can be. But I can't see this as a series. I mean, it wasn't terrible. There's some fun parts with it. I think I will give this a 3.
Wow.
Captain Philip Restisher, I turn to you. How do you rate the pilot we watched? I won't say its name.
I'm giving it a bump. I said it from the beginning. I'm giving it a bump. I've given booby bumps. Given all kinds of different kinds of bumps. Music bumps. Mm-hmm.
Did you mention boobies already?
Yeah.
Okay.
Jason did a 3. Andrew did a 4. Roger did a 5. With my bump, I'm giving it a 6. I had a good time watching
Holy
this.
Holy shit.
I had a good time from the time they threw the baby through the window to get the TVs.
Yeah.
I had a good time with this. No, it's there's no sustainability.
Wow, a 6.
There's no sustainability, but I had fun with this. I had so much fun that I was looking for the songs on the internet. Because they were
fun. That speaks to it, yeah.
So I give it a 6.
Wow.
How much was the booby bump?
One. It's always one.
It's a 1.
Yeah, so I had those 2 boobs. I had a 5. I had a 5. Bumped it up to 6. So
we did a 6, a 5, a 4, and a 3.
That's quite a range.
It really is. And with those scores, we close the book on Cheyenne Cinnamon such and such, and we will never speak of it again.
Yeah.
But join us next time, won't you please, when we watch the pilot episode of Duckworth. Here's a little something to wet your whistle. And an aging investigative TV reporter turns senile. The network focuses him into retirement and replaces him with someone younger. You can find the entire episode of Duckworth by subscribing to Couch Pilots and SoundCloud, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, or your favorite podcast app of choice, and then simply click on one of our classically blue links in our show notes, or go to AdultSwim.com, Blake.
And join the alt-right.
We have to update that, because I'm almost 100% positive that's not correct.
Well... It's just what you've been telling me. So I do what you tell me to.
That's fair, and I appreciate that.
I appreciate you.
Yeah, if someone's got to go to the bathroom or something, please, now's a good time to do it. If you want to listen to our past programs,
I guess
or
we shouldn't go together then. I should wait till he comes back.
Do you usually go to the bathroom?
Well, you said this is a good time to go, and I was like, I got to go, and then Roger stood up.
we got to get one of those troughs where we can all piss in it together.
Like Wrigley Field.
Go to couchpilotspodcast.com. It's got all of our past episodes. It's got all of our ways to contact us, whether it's email or social media, or if you want to give us a call on our Patreon phone number. Or no, it's not a Patreon phone number. It's
Patreon and a phone number.
That's right. It's 2 different things.
Right. So, Andrew, if you and Roger want to give us money, you can go to Patreon and give us some money.
We love money.
The phone number is 910-PILOTS-1, and that's clearly... 910-745-6871. Give us a call, and we'll play your dumb voicemail, or how do you say it?
You get to hear what your dumb fucking voice sounds like.
Yeah, that's why nobody calls.
Well, I'll say this, like, for 300 episodes, not to use a double entendre, but you have been phoning it in regarding knowing the call-in number, but you know it now. I know you're referring to a sheet, but I also... The simple act of you writing numbers on a piece of sticky piece of paper impresses me, which I think means that you don't have to do a lot to impress me.
I did it especially for you. I was like, what will make Jason happy is to finally, after 6 years, learn what 9-10 Pilots 1 is.
Yeah. Baby steps on the journey to making me happy. Thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, that's my alarm.
Hey now, hey now.
God damn, we're going late tonight.
Is that your Taco John's alarm?
It means I have to get over to Taco John's before they close. There's only 25 minutes before they shut their lights off. Andrew, what did you learn being on Couch Pilots for 2 weeks in a row? And I'm sorry.
I tell you, I learned a lot. I learned about love, I think, more than anything else. And there's a lot here.
I didn't expect that.
That was deep. That was deep.
There's the piece of where Blake clearly loves you and is convinced that it's much more than you love him, he's much more important to you than you are to him.
Oh yeah, for sure. Yes. I have always said that Jason is my best friend, yeah, and I'm not Jason's best friend.
Right.
And you know what? I'm fine with that. Mm-hmm. I love the guy. I think that he's very talented. I think he's amazing.
Right.
And if he would invite me to his house once in a while, I'd come over.
Well, can step up your gay game, and then you can come over for sure. you're coming over to my mom's house tomorrow for dinner, right?
That's right.
Oh, you know what?
If you're lucky, I'll let you look in the window in my house.
I would like that very much.
It's changed a little bit since you've been there last.
I tell you what, if you mention my name to his mom, she loves me.
She does love you. She told me, she's said it today even to me.
She did.
She's an amazing person.
Weird.
Yeah.
My mom came on the show and talked about blowjobs.
What's your mom's nickname?
The BJ Queen.
That's not a joke. That's what she really calls herself, the blowjob queen. Yeah.
I'd be
embarrassed if that was my mom.
I'm not. But thankfully, Jason's mom, his sister, his brothers have come on, and I feel like a part of the family. So
you are.
And Andrew, thank you very much. It was a pleasure meeting you.
Thank you.
We were saying to Roger when you were gone there, I asked Andrew what he learned today. I would ask the same of you. What did you learn?
Nothing.
Yeah. Practically the polar opposite of because Andrew said
glasses half empty kind of guy though.
Did you enjoy yourself?
Oh yeah.
Is it what you thought it would be, or better or worse? You can be honest.
It's better.
Okay.
It's good fun. Can you tell?
Not too many women have said that to me.
Yeah, you seem ecstatic. What were you gonna say, Andrew? Though
I mean, his response is consistent with the fact that he's so precious about his "I love yous," and that, whereas I'm not. I'm I have the easy loves. It's all consistent.
There's something to revel in the fact that we haven't changed too, right? That we did not grow here. That we were just we were as consistent as ever. There is something to appreciate about that. I think
we're just four dudes,
just four bros,
chilling out, drinking beers and just talking.
Yep.
And there's a mic in front of us, and we were forced to watch two television shows.
That's all it is.
But it was Roger.
Almost watched all of them.
Well, yeah. You watched one and a half. It's fine. We've had people come in here and be on two shows and didn't watch half of both of them. So,
a lot of people review movies that way.
Yeah.
Is that true? This is what I'll say.
I don't watch
Roger.
Movies, so I don't know.
I cannot imagine a scenario where you're back in this seat without Andrew being there, but you are welcome to be so. You're welcome to do that.
Your imagination is correct.
We'll play for the plane ticket. We'll play
you should hurt my feelings.
I didn't mean it that way.
But you're welcome to come back anytime.
He's your rock.
He's your rock?
Yeah.
Tell him you love him.
I already did. I think he did.
He's given enough love.
That's his way of telling me, I think, right there. That warms me.
I have one more thing.
Okay.
Before we end this big
marathon
jerk off cuddle session, Andrew. You have known Jason for a very long time.
Yep.
Maybe the entirety of my life.
Well, exactly.
It was called suspense. I was building up to it. I want you to give me three things about Jason that you have seen since, three things about Jason that you love, I guess. I guess we're just going back.
What a weird way to put him on the spot.
I want you to get some, I want you to get some
I have a couple things I could say. Like from as a even as a boy, and granted, I was away from him a lot because I'm sorry, I lived far away.
Believe
for
me,
a lot of
everybody wants to be away from him, yeah. So we understand.
But even as a little boy, he was always very smart, and he was a very conscientious about being a good big brother. He really was in a way that was beautiful. I don't know if you feel like you took that seriously, but you did. It was very obvious to me. Another, if you want to.
You had to think about it.
Yeah, thanks, another thing.
Do you remember, so you remember when you were in Portland with Sarah and.
Probably in 1998.
Something like that.
I'd say.
Yeah, and do you remember you sang that song? I don't know if you have that, do you have that recording of.
I think it, we were in your apartment in Portland, and you said let's make a recording, and you got out a guitar, and I think Sarah played maybe some percussion, and we did Free Fallin' by Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers.
That's right.
Yeah,
and it was funny. I was playing guitar, and then I started with you on the drums and Sarah singing, but then it was horrible. Like it was funny. But then we just switched and had you sing and Sarah on the drums, and you were great.
I don't remember being good, but I remember doing it for sure. I may have the cassette at home.
I need to find that recording.
I know. I was thinking I would love to have that, hear that on the karaoke thing. It was like the beginning of something.
You know what's really funny? Recently I did do Mary Jane's Last Dance. That's on it. Right. Yeah. And honestly, I am horrible at singing, and I do a terrible job on that show when it comes to singing, but I think I did pretty good on that song.
All right.
Which is odd to have Andrew sitting right here talking about when I did another song like that. So that,
I'm going to come down drunk in there and make you sing Free Fall.
I would love to do it.
Actually, on that program, I feel like it's the rap songs that you do best.
Yes. Because it's not singing. That's right.
Yeah.
But it's still complicated in a way to it's do like it. To do well,
word.
It's still
it's
difficult.
It's like a beatnik spoken word.
Yeah, I like doing rap on that show, and then also Red Hot Chili Peppers.
Well, because you listen to rap from like 1980,
did I?
Nice and slow.
Oh,
it's like,
I do like old school.
And
rap.
Then we went outside, and
out of you. Jesus Christ. Roger, thank you for being here.
My pleasure.
I'm sorry this is how you had to spend your evening.
Thanks for having me.
Andrew, thank you so much.
We'll unbuckle your wrists here in a second.
I appreciate you listening
you
to the show outside papers? Of this. That's,
for sure.
It's very interesting to me that you listen to this show, but thank you very much.
Oh, thank you. Hey, I love it.
No, we have to isolate that audio. No one's ever said that. This pilot may have been rough, but it is always a smooth flight here on Couch Pilots. Thanks, everyone, and we shall see you next time.
Me love you long time.